Welcome to West Heights United Methodist Church. My name is Randy Quinn, and for one more week, I get the privilege of being one of the pastors who serves here. Yes, you heard that right. This is my last Sunday as a pastor at West Heights United Methodist Church. Next week, we will welcome a new pastor, the Reverend Dr. Trudy Kenyon Anderson, and I am excited about what is in store for West Heights as Trudy comes and as she begins to lead and work alongside of you. It is an exciting time to be a part of the church. For those of you who have been long-term members, you know that change is a part of our tradition. Pastors come and go, but the congregation continues to be a reflection of God's grace in our world. If you're a first-time visitor, I encourage you to come back next week to check Trudy out, or stay with us longer and get to know our congregation. I think you will find what I have learned over the past 4 years. This is a great place to gather for worship and to celebrate God's goodness and God's welcome of you. Welcome to worship.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. In the beginning, before time, before people, before the world began,
God was.
Here and now among us, beside us, enlisting the people of earth for the purposes of heaven,
God is.
In the future, when we have turned to dust and all we know has found its fulfillment,
God will be.
Not denying the world, but delighting in it, not condemning the world, but redeeming it through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit.
God was, God is, God will be.
Place at the table for everyone born, clean water and bread, a shelter, a space, a safe place for growing, for everyone born, a star overhead, and God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy. For young and for old, a place at the table, voice to be heard, a part in the song. The hands of a child in hands that are wrinkled, for young and for old, the right to belong. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Justice and joy. For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear and simply to work, to speak out, to witness and worship. For everyone born, creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy.
Holy God, you were, you are, and you will ever be. On this day of thanking and releasing, we pause to thank you for life and strength, for friends and family and church community, for helpers and the opportunity to help, for the talents and time and resources that give your people opportunities to change the world for good. We thank you, God, for Randy and Rhonda's presence with us these past 4 years. As we send them on their way, may the memories we have made together continue to bless your beloved community. Grant Randy and Rhonda many years of living in your love in retirement. Bless their further mission in the world. Gracious source of all life and strength, we pray your blessing on our congregation as we welcome Trudy and Russ, and as we seek to do your will in our congregation and in the wider world. Give us the wisdom and discomfort and love and trust to know how to be your people in the world today. Guide our feet and our actions. May we do no harm. May we do good. May we stay in love with you. God of grace and glory, we ask that you would continue to light our way. We pray for healing for our loved ones, for our church family members, for all in our circle of care. We pray with those who mourn, asking that your peace that passes all understanding would be felt and known in their lives. We pray for our friends at the Lambert Evangelical Baptist Church in Haiti as we join together in praying the prayer Jesus taught us. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Philippians 4, verses 4 through 9, from the Common English Bible. Be glad in the Lord always. Again, I say, be glad. Let your gentleness show in your treatment of all people. The Lord is near. Don't be anxious about anything. Rather, bring up all your requests to God in your prayers and petitions, along with giving thanks. Then the peace of God that exceeds all understanding will keep your hearts and minds safe in Christ Jesus. From now on, brothers and sisters, if anything is excellent and if anything is admirable, focus your thoughts on these things. All that is true, all that is holy, all that is just, all that is pure, all that is lovely, and all that is worthy of praise. Practice these things, whatever you learned, received, heard, or saw in us. The God of peace will be with you.
Oh, God.
Ron and I have been going through storage boxes at our house as we make room for the stuff that's in my office at the church in our home. It's something that's been on our list for quite some time, but the deadline of my retirement has helped speed the process along. One of the things we found as we were going through those things was a recording of my very first sermon. It was a long time ago. I was in high school at the time. I didn't listen to it because it's on a cassette tape, but I remember some of what I said. And my opening line in that very first sermon seems an appropriate starting point for today's sermon. That sermon a long time ago was part of a youth service. I was asked to preach for 3 to 5 minutes. Another youth was asked to preach for 3 to 5 minutes. Bill spoke first. I knew that when I finished, we had a hymn and then a benediction. As I stepped into the pulpit for that very first time, I could see the clock at the back of the sanctuary, and I did a little bit of math in my head, and I realized we were going to finish at least 25 minutes early. My first line of that first sermon was ad lib. I said, "I'm not sure you're going to get your money's worth today." My sermon today will be a little bit longer than that very first one, but it is intentionally short. I learned a long time ago that if I haven't said what I think needs to be said by now, it's too late to start with my last sermon. Let's listen now to the words of Jesus from the 10th chapter of Matthew. "Those who receive you are also receiving me. And those who receive me are receiving the one who sent me. Those who receive a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. Those who receive a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. I assure you that everybody who gives even a cup of cold water to these little ones, because they are my disciples, will certainly be rewarded." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. There is no question in my mind that we have been well received here, and we have been richly rewarded with warm memories that will linger with us for years to come. Early in my ministry, I served a church that had 3 retired pastors who sat in the pews. As I got to know them and as I got to watch how they approached retirement, I began to imagine what my own retirement might look like. And as I got to see how it worked for these 3 retired pastors, I decided I want to be like David. David had never served that church as a pastor. In fact, most people either forgot or didn't know that he had been a pastor. He simply participated in the life of the congregation. He sang in the choir. He served on committees. On occasion, he would come in and lend me an ear. But for the most part, he was indistinguishable from the other members of that congregation. And maybe it's because I missed the role of being a layperson in the church, but I found his approach to retirement healing to me. And that's when I began to create my own image of myself in retirement. That image is based in large part on how David approached retirement. This week, I will begin living into that model of retirement. For me to live into that model, I will intentionally begin looking for another place to worship. I will look for a place that doesn't know me as a pastor. I will look for a place that values Melissa. Ron and I will probably find a church close to where Melissa lives so that we can pick her up on our way to church on Sunday morning. We may spend a few weeks going to church with our other children where they live. We will probably visit some churches where my colleague friends are serving as pastors. We will probably visit those churches we've served before. Of course, none of that can happen until the doors of churches are open and welcome us into the sanctuary again. But eventually, we will find a congregation that we want to claim as our home church. And I hope they think of me as Melissa's dad, and not her as Reverend Randy's daughter. Now, I don't mean to suggest that we've not been welcome here. Quite the opposite is true. We have been well received in this place, and I am confident that you will have a warm reception for the Reverend Dr. Trudy Kenyon Anderson when she arrives next week. And I also know we will be able to visit West Heights, and someday we will, but not until we have established our identity in a new congregation. And I hope you give us space to do that. And I hope you don't interpret our absence as an attempt to avoid you or to shun you. You see, this isn't about you. This is about me and my retirement. As I shed the role of pastor, a role I've been carrying and wearing for 35 years, I'm going to need space to live into a new reality. And I've done as much as I can to prepare for that event. I have plans for what I will do in retirement. I got rid of most of my books. I gave away most of my stoles, the stole, which is really a symbol of servanthood. It's a reminder of the office of pastor. I've taken those stoles off. This stole that I'm wearing today, I'm going to leave here on the altar for Trudy to pick up next week. It's a way of symbolically passing on the mantle of leadership. You see, I'm leaving the office of pastor. And leaving it here is a visual reminder to you and to me that I do not intend to return for pastoral functions, including weddings and funerals. My tenure as your pastor is finished. And I don't intend to take that role in any other place either. As much as I love being a pastor, as much as I believe God called me to this holy work, as much as I like to believe I've been faithful in following my calling, I'm also ready to retire. The only place I could find in Scripture that directly addresses retirement is in the Law of Moses, in the book of Numbers, where the Levites are told to retire when they reach retirement age. It says that when they reach that age, they are to no longer provide the services. It goes on to say they could assist, but they're no longer to provide the services. I'm ready to let someone else perform the role of pastor. I intend to leave knowing that I've done the best I can. I know I wasn't perfect. I know I failed on occasion. I also know I had successes. And while I missed opportunities, I know I made a positive impact on the lives of many. I leave with a sense of pride in the work I have done and a sense of humility that God has given me the privilege to do so. As I leave, I'm also aware that I have left things undone. Some of those things we simply didn't have enough time to do. Some of those things we're not able to do because of the pandemic. Others were just simply failures on my part. For those times when I failed you, for those times when I hurt you, for those times when I failed to live up to your expectations, I hope you will grant me forgiveness. I know I will forgive you those times when you failed me or let me down. And by you, I mean, the people who sat in the pews in front of me for the past 35 years, not just the past 4 years. I'm looking forward to a new phase of my life, one where my seat in the pews is not defined by my role, but by my desire to be present. As I leave, as I cross this threshold into a new role, I find myself turning to the words of Archbishop Desmond Tutu. They're words I will cling to, words I offer to you as my parting words. Dear child of God, you are loved with a love that nothing can shake. A love that loved you long before you were created. A love that will be there long after everything has disappeared. You are precious, with a preciousness that is totally quite immeasurable. And God wants you to be like God, filled with life and goodness and laughter and joy. God, who is forever pouring out God's whole being from all eternity, wants you to flourish. God wants you to be filled with joy and excitement and ever longing to be able to find what is so beautiful in God's creation, the compassion of so many, the caring, the sharing. And God says, please, my child, help me. Help me to spread love and laughter and joy and compassion. And you know what, my child? As you do this, hey, presto, you discover joy. Joy, which you had not sought, comes as the gift, as almost the reward for this non-self-regarding caring for others. You have cared for me and for my family. I have cared for you and for yours. And in that caring, we have found great joy and share some wonderful memories. And for all of that, I give thanks to God. Thanks. Amen.
I thank you, the members of West Heights United Methodist Church, for the love and support you have shown me while I have served among you. I'm grateful for the ways my leadership has been accepted. I ask for forgiveness for the mistakes I have made. As I leave, I carry with me all that I have learned here.
We receive your thankfulness, offer forgiveness, and accept that you are now ready to leave to retire. We express our gratitude for your time among us. We ask your forgiveness for our mistakes. Your influence on our faith and faithfulness will not leave us with your departure.
I accept your gratitude and forgiveness, and I forgive you, trusting that our time together and our parting are pleasing to God. I release you from turning to me and depending on me. I encourage your continuing ministry here and will pray for you and for your new pastor, the Reverend Dr. Trudy Kenyon Anderson.
Let us pray. Eternal God, whose steadfast love for us is from everlasting to everlasting, we give you thanks for cherished memories and commend one another into your care as we move in new directions. Keep us one in your love forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
May you run and not be weary. May your heart be filled with song. And may the love of God continue to give you hope and keep you strong. And may you run and not be weary. May your life be filled with joy. And may the road you travel always lead you home. May you run and not be weary. May your heart be filled with song. And may the love of God continue to give you hope and keep you strong. And may you run and not be weary. May your life be filled with joy. And may the road you travel always lead you home.
Hey, Randy, this is Dave, which I guess is pretty obvious by looking at the screen. But hey, anyway, I wanted to send you this little retirement video. I'm sitting in my office with my some of my retirement memorabilia from when I left High Touch. And so anyway, I first I guess I wanted to thank you for the steady as you go kind of leadership style that you brought to West Heights. It was very welcomed, and I think that has made a big difference in making West Heights a better church. Also really appreciate your can-do, yes, attitude and ability to, and willingness to take some risks and step out there a little bit on the edge. And I think those are, that's allowed Family Promise to come to West Heights, which has been a real blessing. And it's allowed Cafe Chapel to form, and also continued to allow Watoto to come to West Heights and allow the church and our community to experience their music and stories. Probably most importantly, though, I want to thank you for being the kind of spiritual leader that has provided a space for my personal faith journey to grow and mature. That's been through small groups, your timely and relevant sermons, and also the guidance that you've provided to me when I've needed it. So anyway, congratulations on your retirement. I know it's well deserved. You seem excited, and I'm excited for you. Hope this new phase of your life gives you some new opportunities to explore your gifts and find ways to put those gifts to work to make the world a better place. For me, that's what it's all about. So Terry and I really value our friendship with you and Rhonda, and hoping we can continue that as long as you guys hang around the Wichita area. So let's make it a point to get together. So congrats again. We'll see you Sunday in the pie goodbye line, and wish you well then too. So take care. See you then. Bye.
Hi, Randy. Congratulations on your retirement, and hope you have a wonderful time.
Hey, guys. This isn't goodbye. This is just on to your next life, and we will be in it, so you can't write us off yet. Good luck.
Good luck. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for being our pastor.
We love you, Pastor Randy.
Hi, Randy. I just wanted to let you know how much I've enjoyed your wonderful sermons and your calming presence over the last several years at West Heights. Wish you the best in your future plans and retirement.
Yeah, thanks for being our pastor, Randy, and enjoy your retirement.
Randy, I'd like to thank you for being our pastor at West Heights the last 4 years. Remember back to the first Sunday I met you when we returned from Uganda in 2016. I was unsure about coming back from a trip overseas once again to a new pastor. The highlight of this 4 years with me has been working with you on the reconciling ministries process. I'm not sure without your guidance and suggestions, we would ended up on the positive note that we did. You and Rhonda have become very dear friends to Dave and I.
I want to thank you so much for the presence you've been in my life these last 3 years. What a privilege it's been to work alongside you. Thank you for all the ways you've included me in the life of the congregation.
I'm here for the drive-by pieing.